you know how they say that people complement each other? I think it's true. You know, my husband, he's a fantastic person, but he has that particular habit of doing things at the last minute. He's always on the last minute, whether he's packing his bags for the holidays or he has to bring me somewhere and he knows I have to be on time. And that drives me crazy. Because, of course, I'm a planner, I'm the opposite. I have everything long time before organized in my online agenda. And I hate to be late. Sometimes I think that the problem is that I'm an engineer. And engineers are usually very organized people. But of course, we have to deal with things that have to work for a long time. We cannot do things in the last minute. But how can engineers design something and be sure that this will work for such a long time? It's not just a matter of organizing your online agenda, right? Let's talk, for example, about the transport system. You design a bridge today, and this bridge will be built, let's say, in the next 3 years. And it has to work for 100 years. It sounds incredible, but this is the normality for every engineer. So how can engineers design things and be sure that they will work for 50 or 100 years? Do we even have an idea of the requirement of the traffic system in the future? Because if I design a road today, I have to decide today that this road will be a set amount of meters wide. And I decide it based on the actual requirements of the transport system. But are we sure that this will work for the requirements of the traffic system of the future? Well, the story demonstrates that it has not always been like this, right? So, how can engineers design things and be sure that they will work for such a long life? Do we even have an idea of how the traffic system will be in the future? Electric cars? Maybe no one will even own a car anymore. Maybe we will move in fast pedestrian trains, hidden in tunnels. And this could be not so far in the future. So, how is it possible to design something today and be sure that this will work for the future? Well, Norway has signed up for this particular challenge. This is the E39. It is a European road running for 1,100 kilometers along the west coast of Norway. And today, to drive from Kristiansand in the south of Norway until Trondheim in mid-Norway, where the E39 ends, it takes 21 hours. The long drive is caused by 7 ferry stretches along the road that are even nowadays the only way to cross some of these fjords. Let's take a moment and think about this. There are areas along the E39 where you need 3 hours to reach the nearest hospital. 3 hours. Well, if you have an emergency, you rely on helicopters. Well, if the weather is good enough. So the people living along the E39 must be the healthiest people in Norway, or the luckiest one. I'm joking, but... Well, 1/3 of the national population lives there, and more than 50% of the national export is produced in that area. So this means that there is a huge potential, but this potential requires people, and people require services. They need to reach jobs, hospitals, schools. They need an efficient and reliable transport system. Without a transport system, we are like isolated island and no one wants to live in an isolated place. That's why people are moving, abandoning rural areas and moving to the cities. So that's why we need an efficient and reliable transport system along the E39 in Norway. Now, what about the ferries? You know, in Norway, when people think about ferries, they often think about the sveler, they eat on board. What are the sveler? Well, they are a sort of pancakes. Sorry, I said it. Well, I can share some inside information with you. In Norway, people think that the best sveler you can eat are the one you eat on board the fjord ferries. So that's why people will never abandon the ferries. Okay, joking. But the ferries are a natural way for the truckers to have a break. They are a national touristic attraction. They are part of the Norwegian culture. Ferries will remain, of course. Maybe they will be electric ferries, for example. But for sure, the traffic of the future cannot rely on them. Not only being on time for the time you need to travel, but also for the huge impact that the boats have on the environment. Let's talk about the environment. More bridges, more fixed links, and less boats could be a way to reduce the impact on the marine fauna. And these areas are areas of thousands of marine species that are so precious from the environmental point of view. They are also area of the aquaculture in Norway. And this activity is considered the second oil for Norway. So just try to imagine which kind of impact an increase in the noise in the fjord areas could have on the environment. Huge. So, let's build some bridges. Well, this is not the easiest thing, I would say. Some of these fjords are really wide. They could be up to 6 kilometers. And they can be also really long, deep, more than 1 kilometer deep. So the traditional technology for the bridges is not feasible there. So what can we do? In 2013, the Norwegian government has inserted the crossings along the E39 in a document that is called National Transport Plan. And since then, a complex process has started to develop new technologies to be able to cross these fjords. This could be one of the solutions. Floating bridges. It's an existing technology. We have floating bridges all over the world. And they could fit also for our case. An alternative could be another well-known of bridge, a suspension bridge. But instead of relying on traditional towers, they rely on these tension leg platforms, these floating towers that are used in the offshore field. I know what you're thinking. How can this structure be environmentally friendly? Well, for example, if we think about migratory path of birds, because this could be a problem for some of these fjords. So we do have an alternative, a submerged floating tube bridge. It is a submerged bridge, but floating. The submergence will help us to counterbalance the vertical loads of the structure, taking advantage of the Archimedes lifting force that every submerged body has. And the submergence is also helping us to reduce the main sea load on the structure, like waves, for example. And this is a huge difference with respect to the oversea bridges that are fully exposed to the environmental actions, like winds and waves, currents. And this structure is a way to create a hidden bridge. Well, if you choose the solution with floating pontoons, you can create them as floating island, green island, to minimize the impact on the landscape. But we have to say, there is no solution that can fit for every case. The important thing is to evaluate the best solution for each specific case. But there is one thing that you can do for every application of this structure. You can find a way to design the road in order to produce less CO2. You can find a way to design structures that are more resistant to the environmental loads. You can find new materials, lighter materials, or more resistant materials, materials that help you to design safer structures or more resilient structures. You can use the loads of the nature around you to create green energy. You can do so many things. But how is all this possible? This is the only way to design for the future. It is called research. More than 50 PhDs have been affiliated to the E39 project in Norway in the last years. Design for the future is possible if you invest in people and knowledge. This knowledge will help you today to design the best design you can for your future. It also creates good practice, because also the consultancy will invest in research. It creates jobs for the people hired in the companies. It creates a huge international society that is investing in young professionals coming from all over the world. It creates growth on so many levels. You know, after the publication we have done for the submerged floating tube bridge, many countries have started to think about this solution again. Norway is inspiring. Norway is sharing its experience. Oh, I forgot. This fantastic lady, she is a colleague, and she's the project manager of the Fjord Crossing project, the E39 project in Norway. Let's see if Norway can inspire other nations also on some other topics. Just an example, gender equality. At this point, you will wonder, who am I? I'm the biggest fan of the submerged floating tube bridge. I'm a chief engineer and I work for the Norwegian Public Road Administration, and I'm responsible for the studies on this fantastic structure. I moved to Norway 6 years ago, and I've seen the group of people working on these projects growing. I met people coming from all over the world, and I had the chance to study some of the most exciting topics for an engineer. I also had the opportunity to feel as a part of a huge international community that from Norway to South Korea is working towards the same goal. We have seen some of our projects becoming reality, and we had to face, and we will have to face, opponents for our projects. We discuss, we get angry, and we fight. We fight for what we believe in. It is a huge journey, and I feel so lucky I had a chance to be part of it. I really hope that one day we will see a completed coastal highway route, E39, in Norway. Even if politicians have been farsighted, their priorities can always change in the future. Well, everything can change in life, right? But one thing is sure, one thing will remain: the knowledge that Norway has generated. Because these people, wherever will they be, they will definitely be the people who could plan, could design our future. So do you want to design for the future? Let's start organizing our agenda, because you have to invest in people, you have to invest in knowledge, and you have to start doing it today.